Has been performing photoluminescence studies on quantum dot microdisk structures, which are intended for use in HAMR. HAMR is a next-generation hard drive technology that's designed to solve the current problems that hard drives have. Basically, the current materials that are used in hard drives, they are getting so small that they're running into a limit called the superferromagnetic limit. Basically, what that means is the magnetic nanoparticles are getting so small that they actually randomly flip, so that you can't actually reliably record to them. So HAMR is a way to counteract that by switching to a more stable media. You use a laser to heat the media first, which lowers the stability, then you can change the magnetic orientation of these particles, storing data, and then you can then it cools and your data is stored, and it's highly stable at that point. So a recent proposal has been to integrate what are called near-field transducers with microdisk lasers to basically use as a heating source into the disk media. That offers a couple benefits, namely that you don't have to worry about alignment of the optical path. In this current setup, they have a near-field transducer here that's not labeled, but your laser has to be aligned to that transducer in order to successfully heat the disk. In this, the disk and the near-field transducer are fabricated together. So that way, you don't have that alignment issue. So what I did is I built a microphotoluminescence spectrometer to study the optical characteristics of these disks. A photoluminescence is basically what happens when you take a laser beam, focus it onto these disks. They're made of semiconductor material, so they actually create creates electron hole pairs. Those electron hole pairs are basically excited in high energy states. Those energy states collapse and they give off light. So this is basically an instrument to excite with this laser onto the sample. That light comes back off and goes into the spectrometer. There's a flip mirror here so that you can switch between actually taking your spectrum data and aligning with white light optics. But basically, the wavelengths that you're going to get is determined by the structure of this disk. They have quantum dot layers, which actually act to suck in these electron hole pairs as they're created. Then they recombine, and basically by engineering the size of these quantum dots, you can change the wavelength that they give off. So these curves right here that don't have these what we call mode structures are respectively the wafer as it's grown and then the wafer after transfer. Because the way that these samples are fabricated is this structure actually gets flipped over and glued via epoxy to a glass substrate. Then selective etching using different acids, which only attack either aluminum gallium arsenide or gallium arsenide, are used to remove these etch stop layers. So basically what this is showing is that after transfer, there's no damage to the optical gain medium. After that, they pattern using photolithography into these microdisk structures, which are on the order of 1 to 10 microns in diameter. So at that point, this circular shape actually causes what are called whispering gallery modes. So in old cathedrals, they had what were called whispering galleries, where you could sit on one side and you could whisper, and somebody on the other side could actually hear you very clearly. And the reason that happens is because of auditory modes. In this case, it's optical modes, and that produces these bumps that you can see, which are characteristic of the mode structure. So the first generation disks that we fabricated like this were actually really bad. They had rough edges, and that led to really poor mode structure. It actually looked much more like this unpatterned structure than this very distinct modes that you see. So this is actually a second generation disk, and it has really good mode structure. But the problem with it is that it starts to saturate when you start pumping it with about 300 microwatts of incident power. And it turns out these disks were, in some cases, getting up to over 100 degrees Kelvin hotter. So there's a lot of that was realized as actually a big problem, because the quantum efficiency of these disks is going way down, and there's no chance of them actually blazing. So what we did to try and counteract that is we tried to cool it. So when you cool it, We basically blew nitrogen gas into a coil that was submerged in liquid nitrogen, and then that gas went across the sample. So with the increased cooling, you can see that there's greatly increased intensity of photoluminescence, as well as the gallium arsenide peak is shifting to the left and cooling, showing the cooling is effective. But despite this, there was still no laser. So we did some evaluation on what kind of actual thermal conductance we were achieving. And it turned out it was pretty bad. Essentially, what happened was the fabrication team then decided that they needed, you know, they brainstormed ways to increase the thermal conductivity. What they settled on is they are, instead of using a thick epoxy to adhere the discs to like a glass wafer, they instead use a very thin, about 100 nanometers layer of photoresist, and actually adhered to sapphire, which is a very good thermal conductor. So in that case, you can still see there's mode structures. They're not as well-defined as these. That may be due to disk roughness. But you can also see that we can excite these new generation 3 disks with a lot more power. And there's much better heat sinking. The gallium arsenide peak doesn't rise nearly as much with the same amount of power input into it. So it was kind of successful. And it's possible that they might laser under cooling. We've basically taken them to the limits at room temperature, but in the future, we'll be cooling them down and seeing if we can get lasing that way.